is middle ear and external ear. The competency is parts, blood supply and nerve supply of external ear. First we'll start with pinna. Pinna is a single piece of yellow elastic cartilage except at the earlobe and incisura terminalis. Incisura terminalis is a depression between tragus and the anterior crest of helix. The cartilage is an avascular structure and it is covered by perichondrium. There are three extrinsic muscles for the external ear. They are auricularis anterior, superior and posterior. These muscles are present between auricle and epicranial aponeurosis. They are supplied by temporal and posterior auricular branches of facial nerve. There are six other intrinsic muscles without any useful function in humans. Arterial supply is by external carotid and posterior auricular arteries, occipital artery and superficial temporal arteries. Lymphatic drainage of the external ear goes to mastoid, preauricular, parotid, upper deep and superficial cervical lymph nodes. Then we go to external auditory canal. Its measurements are 9 mm height, 6.5 mm wide and 2.5 cm long. That is 25 mm long. Anterior wall is 6 mm longer than the posterior wall. It is S-shaped. In neonate, tympanic bone is not yet developed, so the tympanic membrane is more horizontal. External auditory canal, it is made up of 1/3 is made of cartilage. And this outer third is directed upwards and backwards. Inner 2/3 is 17 millimeters long and is made of bone. It is directed downwards and forwards. It is formed by squamous part of temporal bone. Fissures and foramen. There is one fissure of Santorini. It is in the cartilage where parotid and superficial mastoid infections can spread to canal and vice versa. There is also one more foramen for Huschke. It is in the bony canal where infections to and from parotid do pass. Constrictions. There are two constrictions in the canal, that is external acoustimators. One is at the junction of cartilage and bony portions. Another is at the isthmus. This isthmus is 5 millimeters from tympanic membrane, where a prominence of anterior wall reduces the diameter. Relations of external acoustimators. Superior is middle cranial fossa. Anterior is temporomandibular joint. Medial is tympanic membrane or eardrum. Inferior is parotid gland. Posterior are mastoid antrum, mastoid air cells and facial nerve. Lateral, that is cartilaginous portion. Arterial supply. Arterial supply, external carotid artery, superficial temporal auricular branches, maxillary artery first part, deep auricular artery, posterior auricular artery, auricular branch. That is the blood supply. Venous drainage goes to external jugular vein, maxillary veins, pterygoid plexus and lymphatic drainage follows that of auricle. Sensory innervation. Roof and anterior wall are innervated by auricular temporal nerve. Floor and posterior wall are innervated by auricular branch of vagus, also called as Arnold nerve. Facial nerve also supplies skin of mastoid and posterior external acoustic canal. Hypostasia of this area of supply occur with facial nerve compression and this sign is called as Hertzberger sign. Hertzberger sign. Then we go to important competency, that is boundaries, contents, relations, and functional anatomy of middle ear and also auditory tube. So in the picture, we can see it is like a matchbox with six sides and different, that is the sides include superior and inferior, that is roof and floor, then medial and lateral, then we have anterior and posterior walls. So this we are going to study in the middle ear. So tympanic membrane, this is the lateral wall. Tympanic membrane forms the lateral wall of middle ear. It is oval in shape. It is concave outwards. Inside, the peak of the cone is called as umbo. This tympanic membrane forms an angle of about 55 degrees with the floor of the external acoustic meatus. So tympanic annulus. Picture shows tympanic annulus. Tympanic annulus is a circumferential fibrocartilaginous ring. It sits on a tympanic sulcus, except at ravinous notch at the canal roof. So we can see location of ravinous notch, that is located at the canal roof. Then layers of the tympanic membrane. Lateral layer of tympanic membrane is continuous with the skin of the ear canal, that is external acoustic meatus. Medial layer is continuous with middle ear mucous membrane. In between, there is lamina propria. In pars flaccida, the lamina propria is less marked. So you can see the area of pars flaccida where lamina propria is less or less or of lesser strength. Then anatomical landmarks of the tympanic membrane. What are the important structures we see in the tympanic membrane? What we see is handle of malleus, that you can see in the malleus. Then there are two folds which are attached to the malleus, that is anterior malleate fold and posterior malleate fold. And there is one pars flaccida, that is in the roof, and the remaining part is called as pars tensa. So these are the different landmarks seen in the tympanic membrane. Then arterial supply arises from branches supplying both external auditory meatus and middle ear. So from the external auditory meatus, the supply comes from deep auricular branch of maxillary artery. From middle ear, anterior tympanic branches of maxillary artery, stylomastoid branch of posterior auricular artery, and middle meningeal artery supply the middle ear. Tympanic membrane nerve supply. The lateral surface is supplied by auriculotemporal nerve and auricular branch of vagus nerve. That is also called as Arnold nerve. Medial surface is supplied by tympanic branch of glossopharyngeal nerve, also called as Jacobson's nerve. Minor contributions are there from the facial nerve. Then we go to study the different walls of the ear, middle ear. So we have already covered the lateral wall. Then we go to floor. So floor is formed by jugular bulb. Then we come to anterior wall. So in the picture you can see structures present in the anterior wall. They are as shown in the picture. Opening of the auditory tube. Then we have internal carotid artery in the carotid canal. Then in the upper part you can see canal for tensor tympani. Apart from that, there are also attachment of anterior malleolar ligament and canal for tensor tympani. So these are the different structures seen in the anterior wall. That is opening for auditory tube, internal carotid artery, canal for tensor tympani, and attachment of anterior malleolar ligament. Then medial wall. So you can see in the medial wall, in the picture you can see, the medial wall consists of promontory and one oval window is posterior superior. Then posterior inferiorly, there is round window. Superior to oval window, there is facial nerve canal. Roof is formed by a thin bony plate that is called as tegmental tympani. Then we go to posterior wall. In the posterior wall, we can see one agitus to antrum. Then one recess is there, facial recess. Then we can see pyramid with stapedius muscle. And the fossa incidus that accommodates the short process of incus. Quadra tympani nerve enters from opening between the posterior and lateral walls. So this is about posterior wall. Then ossicles, we have malleus. Malleus, its head articulates with incus. Its manubrium is embedded between fibrous and mucous membranes of the eardrum. It has a neck and lateral process. Anterior process is near the junction of neck and the manubrium. Incus. Its body has a long process and it articulates with the head of the stapes. Stapes. Its head is connected via two crura, that is anterior and posterior crura, which lead to the foot plate. Its foot plate is attached to the oval window by annular ligament. Muscles. One muscle is tensor tympani muscle. It is housed within tensor tympani canal. It inserts on the malleus at the top of manubrium near the neck. Its contraction stiffens the ossicular chain and it is innervated by the mandibular nerve. Then we have stapedius muscle. It is the smallest skeletal muscle in the body. It is innervated by facial nerve. It inserts on the neck of the stapes. The contraction of the stapes pulls the stapes posteriorly and stiffens the ossicular chain. So the action of the stapedius is opposite that of tensor tympani. So it reduces the energy that is delivered to the inner ear. Then we go to auditory tube. It helps in aeration and drainage of middle ear. It equalizes air pressure to be the same on both sides of eardrum. It extends from anterior middle ear wall to the posterior wall of nasopharynx. Parts, the first one-third part of the auditory tube is surrounded by bone. That is about 3 to 6 millimeters in diameter. Remainder is surrounded by an incomplete ring of elastic cartilage. Meeting point is called as isthmus. The cartilage part forms a valve that protects middle ear from pressure fluctuations in the pharynx. And it also decreases transmission of a person's voice to middle ear cavity. Functions. It has cilia that propel mucus from the middle ear to the nasopharynx. Slit-shaped cartilage part of auditory tube allows transport of material from middle ear cavity to nasopharynx but not other way. At rest, the cartilage keeps the auditory tube or eustachian tube closed. Continuing with the functions, the lumen of the tube is opened by the pull exerted by tensor palatine muscle. This occurs during swallowing and yawning. Negative pressures develop in the middle ear when this mechanism fails to open the auditory tube or eustachian tube frequently and effectively. Negative pressure develops in the middle ear when this mechanism fails to open eustachian tube frequently and effectively. थैंक यू थैंक यू।